Raise your hands if you can hear me.
We can hear you, Julian. Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to Euronews. If you're just joining us, we're now live in London for a statement from Julian Assange.
Without charge, in this country, the United Kingdom, for 5.5 years. That's 5.5 years where I've had great difficulty seeing my family and seeing my children. Today, that detention without charge has been found by the highest organization in the United Nations that is has the jurisdiction for considering the rights of detained persons to be unlawful. I consider the outcome in this case to be vindication. The United Nations Working Group on Arbitrary Detention is the world expert body in understanding the law of when someone is to be detained or not detained. You've heard earlier from lawyers and from the UN itself about the status of the decisions of the Working Group on Arbitrary Detention. But let me repeat them here. The United Nations last night stated that the Working Group's decisions are legally binding. You'll hear more from Balthazar Garzon as to the level of its decisions. They are an opinion juris, which is higher in the hierarchy of international norms than domestic law, than treaties between countries. They are part of the founding basis of the United Nations, which the UK and Sweden are part of. Now, I have read this morning the comments of UK Foreign Minister Philip Hammond insulting the United Nations, calling a decision, which I doubt very much that he's read, ridiculous. I find those comments to be beneath the stature that a foreign minister should express in this situation. This is a serious finding. It adds to a already very important body of international law. And while I understand the momentary political imperatives for representatives of Sweden and the UK to look like they're to look like they were correct in their earlier unlawful decisions, the fact is that they are not. There has been a final decision. There is no ability to appeal the decision of the United Nations. The lawfulness of my detention or otherwise is now a matter of settled law. And Sweden had their opportunity to appeal. The last 2 weeks, they have had that opportunity. They did not lodge an appeal. They cannot now seek to object to the findings of a process which they themselves were involved in for 16 months, a jurisdiction which they submitted to, recognized, and in part founded together with their early involvement in the United Nations. You can't decide that you are going to recognize a forum, take place in proceedings, respond to the other party, and then at the end, when you don't like the outcome because you have been breaking the law and you don't even bother to appeal, come out with press statements and say, well, we disagree, or engage in purely superfluous ad hominem attacks, like saying that a finding is ridiculous. Those statements are simply for domestic consumption. They have no relevancy in terms of law. It is the end of the road for the legal arguments that have been presented to date by Sweden and the UK. Put simply, those arguments lost. There is no appeal. The time for appeal is over. No appeal was lodged. So I want to turn a little bit to where things go from here. It is now the task of the states of Sweden and the United Kingdom as a whole to implement the verdict. Now, why there can be attempts for the media, for the popular press, to look tough and attempt to undermine that, a serious attempt, not just for show, would have the effect of undermining the UN system. And there are consequences of doing that. And Sweden and the UK know full well that there are consequences. Those consequences include not merely weakening a human rights and international law instrument to which both countries have signed binding treaties, but rather it will have the diplomatic effect, and diplomats know it. The diplomatic effect will be to make life difficult for Sweden and the United Kingdom to be treated seriously as an international player, as international players that obey their international legal obligations. Their attempts, if they proceed to undermine the UN system, we'll see various enforcement measures that can be taken by the UN. Those initially, of course, can include the removal from UN committees, movement against those states in various voting processes, and ultimately up to and including sanctions. Now, that's, of course, a matter for the UN to decide about how it's going to enforce its decisions, and a matter for Sweden and the UK to think, do they really want to go down that path? But we have now a victory and decided law on this case. This is a very interesting case. I suggest everyone go and read the result of the UN working group. WikiLeaks has tweeted it. You can also look on Justice for Assange that's in the background here. And finally, I would like to thank the UN for considering over the last 16 months our submissions and those of the various states, and producing this verdict, which adds not just to my freedom and to justice for my children, but it adds, I think, significantly to the ability of the UN to deal with complex cases of arbitrary detention, including those involving Western states. Now, this victory came about not just because of the situation I am in, but because of a lot of hard work. And that hard work is from, first of all, Balthazar Garzon and John Jones QC, who had the initial a strategic vision to bring this case. Melinda Taylor, who just presented, was the principal drafter. Stella Morris and Kerry Schenkman were secondary drafters, helping to pull all the other contributions together. Those other contributions came from Gareth Pearce of the UK, Michael Ratner, President Emeritus of the Centre for Constitutional Rights, Eric Borge from Oxford, Jennifer Robinson, who you heard at the beginning, and Candela Zussman, who is there in the audience. So with that, I would like to say thank you. Did I miss my family? But we have today a really significant victory that has brought a smile to my face, and I hope many others as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Julian. I'd now like to pass over to the coordinator of our international legal defence, Baltazar Garzon. Please bear in mind and